ding 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 ding. There he sits inside your local coffee shop, sporting a man bun and facial hair. Somehow he believes, although he has no job, that by his 30s he will be a millionaire. M-I-L-L-E-N-N-I-A. Gotta love millennials. M-I-L-L-E-N-N-I-A. Posts lots of selfies on her Instagram with a quote that's inspirational. Hopes to change the world while wearing yoga pants, armed with her dreams and knowledge of essential oils. M-I-L-L-E-N-N-I-A. Gotta love millennials. M-I-L-L-E-N-N-I-A. Criticism isn't easy for their ears. They feel like they know most everything. See, they grew up with undeserved confidence, 'cause they got trophies just for participating. M-I-L-L-E-N-N-I-A. Gotta love millennials. M-I-L-L-E-N-N-I-A.
I'm sorry, but not sorry, for what's about to happen over the next 35 minutes or so. Because for the last 3 minutes or so, about 70% of you had a real good laugh. But about 30% of you felt incredibly stereotyped. Pigeonholed. Again, I'm sorry, not sorry, but about 30% of you felt alienated. Yeah, I kind of teed you up for that one. See, we don't take a lot of time to learn to know those born between the years of 1981 and 2001. We stereotype them as immature, irresponsible, those failing to launch, beard growing, skinny jeans wearing, coffee drinking millennials. What's even more sobering is I tried to look for some definition of millennials, and I stumbled upon the Urban Dictionary definition of millennials, which don't show it yet, because what's most sobering is that chances are, because it's involves technology, it was written by a millennial. And here's a perceived definition, probably by a millennial for a millennial, a name an old person gives a young person they don't like. So here's the deal. After preaching it once and having some conversations before now, I wrestle with how to approach this with you all. Because when you're sitting in your office and you're putting stuff together, it sounds so easy to communicate. And then you look at that as the people you're communicating with. And I want to tell you, it's kind of like something I tell my kids. And if you're twice my age, I don't look at you as my kid. Don't hear that, right? Don't hear that. But I love you too much to talk to you about this. All of you. Because I get an amazing gift every Sunday night of having 12 to 20 millennials at my house. And they are some incredible, underused, underdeveloped resources that this church has. So I want to talk to you about that. This is week three in our series called Losing Our Marbles, which is built around this jar of marbles that we now give out to every parent who dedicates their child. And every marble in here represents 1 week in the life of a child and teenager before they leave the home. And the idea, we tell parents to do this, it's a tough task, but every week in their life, you pull out one more marble. And you watch the weeks disappear and the time you have left to invest in your kids disappear. And if you walk around the church, you'll see jars of marbles out there, jars of marbles in every area, and you'll find that the older they get, the more sobering it becomes. My oldest son has less than 24 marbles in his jar. That's not a lot of time. So the idea of losing your marbles too, the phrase is a double entendre, which means there's one phrase has two different meanings. It's both about investing in a generation while we still have time before we lose our marbles with them. It also, losing your marbles means going crazy. Losing your mind, right? Because the very reality as well is, for the full, I guess the full scope of this meaning is we invest in every generation as long as we have time with them. Even those generations that drive us crazy. Mark, I got some crazy feedback going on right now. You want to check my mic real quick? I keep hearing voices and it's mine. I kind of like it. Just think you get two sermons out of one if I keep this up, right? You're getting your money's worth. All right. So, I want you to recognize something too. I want you to recognize it's what we don't know that scares us. It's what we don't know that drives us crazy. It's people we don't understand that drive us crazy as well. And that's what makes this so difficult in dealing with and putting value in different generations. See what the deal is, this jar is really a microcosm of a bigger story going on, because there are marbles for every week in every one of our lives as well. This is just a part of our lives. But throw it up there. If you were just an 18-year-old, the idea is you have about 939 marbles in your jar before you graduate and leave the home. But if you live to be 40 years old, you have over 2,000 marbles, as well as 55 years old or 65 years old, over 3,000 weeks in your life. You get to be 80, you have 4,172 weeks in your life that you have time for us to invest and place value in. Well, that seems like a lot of time. See, we believe it's important to talk about all generations investing value in, because we believe that formation and redemption happens at all stages of life. See, we don't wait to invest in our kids until it's almost empty, do we? Because formation and redemption happens all through childhood and adolescence. But we at Dayspring believe the same for every human. That formation and redemption happens whatever age you are at. Till your last breath, it can take place. So we invest at all ages and convey value to all generations as long as we have time off. That's the other part of it too. I mean, I can say a kid has, 900 some marbles, 900 some weeks in their lives, but you and I don't know that. You don't know how long you're going to be here. I'd like to think we'd all get to be 85 years old, but we're not going to wait until someone's 80 years old and then start conveying value. Are we? We don't know how much time we have left in the life of any individual, so we, church, start investing and conveying value to all generations right now. And that's why there's this urgency in this Losing Your Marble series. Because one of our vision statement right now is to convey value to all generations of life. That's what we're shooting toward. And today, we've talked, last 2 weeks, talked about children, talked about adolescents, talking about millennials. We'll get to Gen Xers, my generation, next week, and we'll move into the older generations, the boomers and beyond, with one final week with Pastor Chuck. So let me just start out, let me introduce you to the millennials, all right? This is the scientific definition, the sociological explanation for the characteristics of millennial. Now, I'm not trying to stereotype. This is not stereotypes. This is not pigeonholing. This is not caricatures. But in studies, this really kind of sums up how millennials are and how they are shaped. It's people born between 1981 and 2001, roughly. 2001's a pretty good cutoff. Well, you'll see why in just a second. But before that, not so much. It's kind of foggy. I'm kind of a bridger. I'm in 1977. I'm right close, but not quite. But I have characteristics of a millennial. But we're running with 1981 to 2001. Let me introduce you to a millennial. Okay? The most formational things in their lives, the most formational events, were 9/11. Which is why millennial ends in 2001. They're shaped by social media and by the quick rise of technology through their lifetime. Everything got quicker and faster and better constantly. Faster in that time and more emphasized through the 80s and 90s as well. That has shaped them, all right? Remember, these things aren't bad or good. They just are, okay? For millennials, this is the first generation in America where divorce and single-parent families are the norm. It was new to us, the Xers. It is the norm beginning with this generation. Generally speaking, this is a very optimistic generation. They believe in the best of what the church can be, the best of what humanity can be, the best of what a nation can be, the best of what a world can be, and they're pursuing what is best. They think that we got a shot. When it comes to work, they are their careers that they launch, they're actually looking for, in generally, a work-lifestyle balance. And I emphasize lifestyle on the screen because they tend to err toward the lifestyle. It's still a balance they're trying to, but they want to pursue the lifestyles maybe a little more important than the career. Which in part explains the next part. Because when it comes to career, they're looking for careers that have value, that are meaningful, and provide instant results and feedback. The instant results and feedback have a lot to do with technology. Because things happen immediately right now. A rather impatient generation. Because they can be. Because things happen all right away. Now, this was what kind of causes a conflict between us older generations and millennials. Because it's not that, because we perceive it as, well, they jump from job to job to job. They just can't hold a job down or just don't want it. No, it's because they're pursuing meaning in a career. And they'll keep searching until they find it. And because they're trying to balance work and lifestyle, but will err towards lifestyle, they will change jobs to sustain the balance of their lifestyle. My generation up was different. So we went for a work balance, work lifestyle balance, but we would err towards the work. So we would keep adjusting our lifestyle to adapt to the career that we were building, and more than not, stuck with our career. And if you look at generation beyond that, with boomers, you tended, and beyond, tend to stick with one career for a long period of time, because one of the tendencies of a boomer is that you just wasn't about balance, it was about the career. And when I retire, then lifestyle starts. Fair? It's not bad or good, it's just what is. It's why we look at millennials as lazy. They're just looking for a balance with an emphasis on lifestyle. Oh, okay. I can run with that. Their Christian perspective is a little bit different as well. Now, same Jesus, same God, same church, same Bible. But they look through the lens of what's called moralistic therapeutic deism. Woo! Let me draw it back here a little bit. This is Christian Smith. He's a sociologist from Notre Dame, did a lot of work on surveying adolescents and young adults. And this generation, this is how they view Christianity. Let me break it down a bit. They view Christianity as what informs moral action. Now, the little flaw in here is we know that it should be the change of the heart that affects moral action. So when they are evangelistic, they're changing people's actions, but sometimes they forget through social justice that it starts with the heart. But they're drawn to the moralistic part of it. It's moralistic, it's therapeutic. They are more than likely drawn to what helps them feel better. Not just feel happy or good, but things that make their life better. But we've been studying a lot through here the last several months that Jesus himself said, in this life you will have troubles, but fear not, I've overcome the world. So that's kind of the disconnect sometimes. There's stuff in the Bible that's hard. There's stuff this morning that's going to be hard to hear. Right, that's okay. But they're drawn to the therapeutic. And I keep saying they, all right? Next week when I talk about Gen Xers, I will say we, all right? This is not an us and they. We're seeking to understand today, okay? I'm not labeling. I'm clarifying. And lastly, deism. This is a theological term of how God is viewed. Deism is the theology that God created the world, but then backed off and lets us figure it out by ourselves. God is not active right now. It's our work to build his kingdom now. Still same God, still same Jesus, still same church and same kingdom, but it's our work, not his, and he's not active. He's not healing, he's not speaking, and eventually he'll come back and make it all better again. But we as Wesleyans believe in a theistic God, a God who made everything, and from the beginning of time, through the Old Testament, with the incarnation of Jesus and with his Holy Spirit, now is still acting. That's why there's a disconnect. It's not because they're bad. That's the Christianity that they've maybe been taught or at least are drawn to. And lastly, this is one of the most tolerant generations. That's a scary word. Because does it mean they're more liberal? Or does it mean, actually, they're actually more gracious and patient and waiting on people to find God? Huh. I just want to open up the door to understanding millennials. Now, as much as I'm concerned about the human sociological definition, explanation of millennials, I'm more concerned about how God views millennials. To help answer the question of what are they here for the church for? What's their role in our midst? Now, I'm going to say just real quick as a caveat, what I love about Dayspring and what Dayspring can do and potentially mean to this community is this church has an incredible balance of all generations. That is weird in a very holy way. Most churches are either all older or all younger. We got it all, and by the time we're done here today, you're going to see why that is so important. See, we're going to look at Joel. Joel is a prophet about 25 years ago, all right? Now, you might be asking, why are we studying prophets who were speaking to other nations 2,000 years ago? We need to talk to Dayspring today. Well, this is why it matters, church. This is why we listen to them. Because prophets weren't just telling the future. In the Old Testament, prophets were people who heard from God and spoke on his behalf. Prophets were the mouthpiece of God. So when a prophet spoke, they were faithfully speaking God's words. So when we hear God's words, we get a glimpse of his heart and his mission and his purpose for us. Because we believe in a God who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So when we study and look at what God said through prophets, hear his voice 2,500 years ago, we know that's the same words that apply to us right now. That's why this matters. That's why in studying millennials, people born in the last 30 years, why we can go 2,500 years ago and make some sense out of it, all right? All right, let's go. I'm going to read out of the book, the translation, The Message, just a fresh take on the Word of God. So if you don't have, you can follow along in your NIV reading out of Joel 2, but if you want to follow along and really make sense of it with me, you can follow along on the screen, all right? Roll with me here. But there's this, also this, it's not too late. God's personal message. Come back to me and really mean it. Come fasting and weeping, sorry for your sins. Change your life, not just your clothes. Come back to God, your God, and here's why. God is kind and merciful. He takes a deep breath. He puts up with a lot. The most patient God, extravagant in love, always ready to cancel a catastrophe. And that's just the beginning. We're jumping to verse 28. After that, I will pour out my spirit on every kind of people. Your sons will prophesy, also your daughters. Your old men will dream. Your young men will see visions. I even pour out my spirit on the servants, men and women both. Before the judgment day of God, the day tremendous and awesome. Whoever calls help God gets help. On Mount Zion and in Jerusalem, there will be a great rescue, just as God said. And included in the survivors are all those who God calls. We have said for many years, this is our next generation of leaders, right? But implicit in studying and saying that they're the next generation is that they aren't capable of being leaders now. That's what we're saying. We're saying that they're just immature right now. They don't have enough life experience right now. We're saying that they're just not committed enough right now, which I guess implies we're all committed enough to tithe our 10% already. It means that they don't know how to do church well enough yet, which I guess implies we know how to do church perfectly now. And so because they aren't equipped to lead, prepared to lead right now, we place them in children's ministry. Not because they can lead, but because they're the breeders. Your kids, your problem. Right? I mean, that's a little bit accurate, okay? You're a millennial. Yeah, you're a bridge to 1980. I gotcha. We put them in youth ministry, not because they're good leaders, because they're the only ones with enough energy to keep up with the teens. Yeah? Fair? Yeah? I mean, I was a youth pastor 10 years. I was looking for young youth leaders because I couldn't get any people over the age of 40 to come help. And I realized, wait, they don't just need people that can run with them. They need, because they're growing up in an age where divorce and single parent families is the norm, they need surrogate parents, extra grandparents in their lives. Huh. I'm playing to our stereotypes, people, because I want to speak truth. So I want to walk with you through this, because what God does in this passage, he first opens things up by providing a request. So understand, Joel is talking to the nation of Judah right now. After King David, the nation split between two different kingdoms, Israel to the north, Judah to the south. And at this time, Israel had already been conquered, had already been blown up, had already been taken away in captivity, but Judah's about, they're ready to be had, all right? So Joel is calling out saying, listen, change, quick. God may allow you to avoid a catastrophe, but here's the voice of God saying to these people right now in the midst of possible destruction. His first request, come back to me. He doesn't say, come back to church, does he? I'm going to put that up there. Come back to me is not the same as come back to church. Doesn't say come back to the temple, come back to me. See, we're good at inviting people to church or telling people you should go to church or thinking that's too good. Oh, you go to church, that's enough. Nah, he wants people to come back to him, not just get in these seats. He wants you. He wants a relationship. He wants disciples of Jesus Christ and not just singers of Jesus Christ, not just listeners of Jesus Christ, not just worshipers of Jesus Christ. He wants disciples of Jesus Christ. So he says, come back to me, not to church. Church is not the end, folks. Get people to church. Church is a means to get to him. And that's what he says next. He says, change your life, not your clothes. In other words, I want you to change what's in here, not what's out here. Don't just change your actions, change your heart. That's what I want. And to get to that point, church, we've got to become aware of the current reality that we're in. We've got to become aware, one, that we are sinful people. Remember, it's not us and they now, this is a we. We are sinful. Once we become aware we're sinful, we come to the place of becoming aware that we need forgiveness. And once we become aware of our need for forgiveness, we reach out and become aware that we need a God. And once we respond to that request of reaching out to our God, we provoke God's response. You ready to roll with this? This was so great. God does the first work, we do the second work, then God does the third work. He's doing far more than we're doing. We have a theistic God. He's doing stuff. Once we respond, we provoke a response on his part. And here's his response in the scriptures. After that, I will pour out my spirit on every kind of people. Your sons will prophesy, so will your daughters. Your old men will dream. Your young men will see visions. I'll even pour out my spirit on the servants, both men and women. The response to repentance and obedience is that God will pour out his spirit. And here's what I want you to see through this. There's the first part, okay? Did you notice who gets his spirit? You see, God's not playing favorites. God doesn't favor one age over another age, older over young or younger over old. He doesn't favor men over women. They're both involved. He doesn't favor people of one tax bracket over another one. No generation has an edge when it comes to receiving God's Spirit in their lives. I'm telling you this because though I'm talking about millennials, it's there for all of you. I want this for all of you to receive his Spirit and watch what happens. And then check out what happens. Here's the cool part. They start doing the unnatural. Your old men, and implicit in there is old women, you will start to dream dreams. All right? Here's the problem with, and that's in your notes, go ahead. The older generation, they become the dreamers. There you go. Which doesn't make sense for older generation, because dreams are things that God places in your mind of what he is about to do. It's not pie in the sky. This is God planted dreams of what is about to happen. The problem, we stereotype older generations, they're the ones who tend to look back to the past, longing for what was, feeling as though they're losing everything and God's showing them, but I'm about to show you something new. Maybe you can't do what you used to do, but listen, in your grief, that you're losing your abilities, you're losing your health, you're losing your school, your skills. I'm about to do a new thing. Me, through you, but it's me. Goes against the nature of an older generation individual. Then it says the young men and women, all right? That's my generation. They become visionaries. Okay? This becomes a little counterintuitive too. My generation, we're basically the second half of the workforce. We are now working toward our retirement. We are looking this far ahead. Get us there, and then we're home free, right? But all of a sudden, we become the visionaries. A vision is something that's set far out away, far beyond what we can get our minds around. A goal that we may never attain, but we start shooting towards and pointing towards. It's far beyond retirement. It's far beyond the next tax return. It's far beyond the end of my business. It's far beyond the next promotion. It's far beyond getting my kids out of the house. It's far beyond getting them through college. We can't see that far. It's against our nature. We become the visionaries that see what's far beyond us. And then your sons and daughters, our millennials, they become prophets. So in your notes, older generation, dreamers. Middle age, visionaries. And the younger generation, our millennials, they become prophets. Now listen, understand what that means. We tend to look at prophets as the soothsayers, the foretellers. They're going to prophesy about something that's about to happen. Prophets' responsibility was to call people back to obedience to God. Not their purpose was not to point out what was wrong, but to point out what can be right. But millennials are too immature, right? They don't have enough life experience to tell us what's right, do they? They don't have enough wherewithal to know how to function here in a church. That's what's so crazy about being a spirit-filled individual, is that because it's God at work and not you at work, the things that are coming out of your mouth, the things that start coming from your body at work are against what is humanly possible. Because it's His work, not yours. Come on now. And here's what's so great. What's so great is that I believe God places all these individuals, all these generations, all these prophets and visionaries and dreamers all within the church at the same time. Eventually the prophets will become the visionaries. The visionaries will become the dreamers, because we can't do without any of them. We need the dreamers to keep reminding the prophets who can't figure out why people can change, can't change, the visionaries whose minds are set to the grindstone to get through this life and get their hands and accomplish things, that this is not your work. This is His work. Stay faithful, stay true. We can't do without the visionaries. Because the dreamers, the older generation can still be looking back to the past, and the younger generation, again, frustrated about why this change is not happening. The visionaries remind them, there's something more we're shooting for. You keep pointing that direction, keep working that direction together, and His kingdom come, His will be done here in Marion before you know it. Folks, we need the prophets. Both of the older generations still need the prophets. Not to tell us what we're doing wrong, but to point to us what is right. Lest we get settled in regurgitating our old way of doing church, our old ways of accomplishing what was, instead of constantly pursuing what is according to His word and what can be in this lifetime, much less beyond, which is far better. This is a taste. See the roles we all play? See how things change? So in light of that, when you're dealing with a spirit-filled anybody, a spirit-filled visionary, a spirit-filled dreamer, a spirit-filled prophet, don't you dare throw yourself in front of that train and try to stop it, because it's not them, it's Him, and you'll merely get run over. Listen, it could be the greatest thing that could happen to you, but what's far better is jump on the train. Come to a place of humility. Come to a place of repentance and get a taste of that spirit that God Himself, through the prophet, promises is available to each of us, irregardless of age, irregardless of gender, irregardless of brokenness, irregardless of socioeconomic status, irregardless of how long you've been in the church, irregardless of how long ago you left the church. Don't stop me. This is not a word of condemnation, but a word of hope and possibility if we start listening and see what God intends to do here in the days going forward. So, back to the jar. In light of all this, how do we show value then to a millennial? You with me? Now we can get to those notes, all right? First thing you got to do is you listen. That seems like really, duh. But here's what's implicit in here. This is important. This implies that you right now are close enough in a relationship to a millennial to actually trust them and hear from them. Do you have any millennial in your life besides your kids or your grandkids that you're close enough to and trust that when they speak, you listen and hear? That's one. So easy put, get in a relationship. Start investing in someone younger than you. Second one, let them lead with us. The only difference between a prophetic millennial and the visionary and the dreamer is maturity. Sorry, wisdom and maturity probably too, but wisdom, that's the one I'm going for. And they both need each other. Because a prophetic individual without wisdom, knowing how to do that, can probably act upon their prophetic word without love and alienate and ostracize and just deflate and demoralize individuals. But wisdom without a prophetic voice in their lives becomes a stale, stagnant church who has come to the place of believing we've got this figured out. Smooth sailing till Jesus comes back. And I want more than that. So let them lead with us. So we can tap into their prophetic voice and they can tap into some wisdom God has given us who have served with a spirit-filled life for several years or decades. Fair? And then we can also, when it's appropriate, follow their lead. I'm going to lower the bar, not for them, but for the rest of us, as low as I can, to help you see really how easy it should be to listen to the voice of a spirit-filled millennial. In Numbers, God spoke to a guy named Balaam through a donkey, and Balaam listened. Check it out. In Exodus, God spoke to a man named Moses, who was well over 60 years old, through a bush that was on fire. And Moses listened, went back to Egypt and liberated 2 million Israelites out of 400 years of bondage and slavery. If some of the greatest humans can listen to inanimate objects and follow God because he spoke through them, why do we struggle to listen to a human being created in an image of God, full of God's Spirit, just because they're a little bit younger and quite a bit different than us? Give it a shot sometime. Follow their lead. And there's one more thing I shared it first, I didn't get on the notes as I was praying about and going through it this morning. I realized there's one more thing I want to throw out there. I really want us to check ourselves when it comes to dealing with millennials. I don't want this spirit-filled life to be a bar, a finish line, a measuring stick for when an individual can become one who leads with or leads us, or one who becomes worth listening to. Rather than making it a bar till we can begin, start praying for them. Start pursuing them. Communicating to them, I want this for you. I'm waiting on you, not till you get better. I need you. We need you. As soon as the Spirit of God comes in you, I'm ready. And if you call me out on something, I'll give it a shot. And see if it's God at work. But if we're too busy setting a bar, a measuring stick that we create till they are capable of being leaders in any capacity here at the church, then we should probably take a step back. And I say this with 100% love because I had to do it a while ago. Whether or not God's Spirit is truly in us, if that's holding us back. What's going to be fun about fun? This wasn't all fun. We're not moralistic therapeutic deists. This was not necessarily therapeutic today. But it's truth. What's going to be great about these sermons, and I think you picked up on it when Chuck was talking, he was talking about teens, but he wasn't just talking to parents of teens. Stuff applied to everybody. Today I'm not just talking about to you about millennials. This message is for millennials. So I'm going to do something out of pure love right now. And it won't take long. Take a few minutes. So bear with me. If you were born between the years of 1981 and 2001, will you please stand up just now? Now, some of you are like, I'm 38 and I get to stand up with 18-year-olds. And some of you are like 42, like, come on, a few more years, I want to stand. This church is not dying. Look at this. This church is not dying. Now listen, I want to talk to you millennials, all right? Because this is a word for you as well. So listen, I love you too much to not share this with you, because you guys, this is most of these people are in my edge group. They come to my house every Sunday night. Every Sunday night, 18 to 26-ish year olds come to my house for dinner and we explore God's word. We do stupid stuff together to grow together till this group finds their place in the body of Christ. If you got an 18 to 26-ish year old, or you are, see me after church. Come to our house tonight, 6:30. Tonight, we're going to have tacos and we're going to ask a hard question. Does God speak? What is his will for our lives? And how can I know his voice? We're going to solve all the world's problems tonight. But for the rest of you, maybe a little older as well, millennials, hear this. This is what this means for you. This is your challenge. If you want a piece of this spirit-filled life that we talk about, and I'm not condemning you, I want this for you, every one of you, whether on the low end of millennials or the high end of millennials. It's still got to start with humility and repentance. It's still got to start there. Not because you're a bad person, because this is the greatest opportunity of your existence. Start there. Speak in love. When God spoke to prophets, when God shared through prophets, they had some hard things to say. But they did it either for weeks or years out of a desperate love for the God they serve and the people they were speaking to. So if you have a harsh word to say, but it's not rooted in love, be patient until it is. And next part is, it's part of your nature. Acknowledge your impatience. You want things to happen yesterday? All right? But these prophets in the old Bible, if you're a prophet in the Old Testament, they sometimes spoke for months and years and still never saw it happen. Some of them saw it. Some of them died before the change happened, before the prophecies were fulfilled. So listen, have patience with us. Church needs you. Hang on to him. Hang on to the church. Hang on to the Spirit living in you. And don't keep silent. And last of all, let God work. We have a theistic God who he is changing the world through you. And I pray to God, not in spite of you, because he can do far more through you than around you. So stop trying to solve the problems yourself. Wait on him and watch what he does when you allow him to speak and move and work through you. Watch what he does with us old people. Kathy, you like that. I'm 41. And I'm an old person. Just for today. Would the rest of you stand right now? Because you're part of this. The prophets, the visionaries, the dreamers, you're all out there. And we need all these roles. But we can only have all these roles fulfilled, church, if the Spirit of God is in you. He's at work in you. Don't be silent. Don't be disobedient. Move with him.